The Datsun 1600 or Datsun 510, as it's also known, is actually a relatively unusual car to see competing here at World Time Attack. So when we saw John's immaculate version competing in open class, we had to come and take a closer look. So John, for a start, maybe could you give us a high level view of what the open class rules are?
Yeah, look, I think it just gives you those extra freedoms that you'd have in club sprints. So, you know, there's just, you can do lots more with suspension. It's not, gearboxes are much the same now, but yeah, aerodynamics and suspension is probably the biggest differences between the cars.
Okay, the 510 or Datsun 1600, sort of the aerodynamics of a brick. So on face value, if you were starting with a blank sheet of paper, I wouldn't think maybe it's the best option to go with. What is it about this car that you've sort of fallen in love with?
Yeah, look, I like Datsuns. I've always liked them. I've got a road car and this came up and it's just, yeah, it's not, for me, it's not about going out and win. We're not going to be in that realm. It's just about having fun and having something a little bit different that looks cool.
All right, let's talk about the engine combination because these did not come out of the fact sheet with a SR20. So talk us through what you've got in there.
Yep, so it's an SR20, non-VE, turbocharged with a BorgWarner EFR turbo, and it's got a Samsonas sequential gearbox as well. So.
Okay, let's dive a little bit deeper into the engine. You just mentioned not a VE. So what you're talking about there is the P11 and P12 Primera VE or VVL cylinder head kind of Honda's VTEC mechanism.
Yep.
There's been a game changer with SR20 performance. I guess you're not running that, so can you talk us through your reasonings there?
Yeah, look, it's obviously, it's developed over time, the car. It started out very basic and I'm trying not just to change everything at once and trying to learn as we go. So power wasn't the ultimate goal because it was fast enough. Now we put some aero on it probably does need some more power, so that'll be the maybe next step.
Okay. In terms of the power it's making at the moment, where are you at and what sort of boost pressure are you using to produce that?
Yep, so it's 350 kilowatts of the wheels on E85 with 25 pounds.
Okay, that's definitely, it's definitely no slouch.
No, it's stout for what it's got, for absolutely.
You've mentioned BorgWarner EFR, but which particular turbo out of that range?
It's a 7670 external wastegate, so it runs twin gates with a full race manifold on it.
And what sort of usable power band have you got in terms of what RPM are you seeing usable boost and what are you revving it through to?
It basically starts pulling from about 3.5 and on the front straight last year, we're not quite hitting the same, but it was 7,800 at 245 k's an hour. So it was the maximum revs.
One of the potential pitfalls of the original SR20DE and DET heads is the rocker assembly.
Yep.
Well known for problems, particularly at high RPM, because it's not a shaft-mounted rocker. That VVL cylinder head does solve that. Have you had any issues, and if so, how are you sort of resolving that with that rocker system?
Yeah, look, touch wood. No, haven't had any. Sort of one of the first things people mention is, you know, get rockers flying off it, but no, we haven't had any at all. So,
I mean, from my own experience, having tuned hundreds of SR20s, I think the two things that kill these is using an ignition cut rev limiter and also excessive RPM. So, obviously, 7,800, not too extreme there, so that's probably one of the keys, I would imagine.
Yeah, look, absolutely. I think, you know, shift cut set up properly and yeah, being kind on the downshifts is certainly a contributing factor.
On that shift cut, I'm guessing there you're talking about using a fuel cut instead of an ignition cut for that reason on the shift?
Yeah, look, I'm not 100% sure of the full details, but yeah, it's set up, so it's...
That would be the typical approach, and a lot of people get in trouble using an ignition cut for the reasons I've just mentioned. Let's talk about the rest of that engine combination internally. Again, 350 kilowatts, no slouch, but you're not setting any records for the SR platform.
No.
Anything particularly special in terms of piston rods and crankshaft?
No, I actually don't know the full history of the bottom end, so we redid the head with new Kelford cams, 272s, head gasket, and the plan eventually is to do a proper engine for it. So it'll be probably go 2.2 stroker with a crank or something like that.
Again, on the open class, you don't have an engine capacity limit, so you're free to do what you want there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Dry sump system, though, kind of an essential really for reliability in a circuit application.
Yeah, look, you know, through work, we've been through Time Attack a lot, and lots of cars, they come here and, you know, we say, look, you need these things, and I don't want to spend the money on a dry sump, and as soon as you put sequential gearboxes and hold the revs up there, and they destroy an engine by the time they get to turn two, and it's just it's an expense, but it's a safety measure.
Yeah, it's a bit of pill to swallow at the time. It is definitely a lot of money to be spending, but it only takes one engine to be destroyed, and all of a sudden, it seems like quite cheap insurance. Electronic system in the car, talk us through the ECU and the rest of the electronics. What are you running?
So it's got EMtron Kv8, MoTeC PDM15 and a C125 dash.
Okay, reasonably common system there. The PDM or power distribution module, what are you controlling with that? Is that doing all of the power management for every part of the engine and the rest of the chassis as well?
Yes, yep, yep. So probably a little bit tapped because it's got electric power steering in it and obviously fuel, all the rest of it, but yeah, that's running everything in the car.
Talk us through that electric power steer. Why'd you go that route instead of hydraulic, which would be a little bit more conventional?
Obviously, well, so not obviously, but Datsun's come with a steering box originally. So we've put a steering rack into it and the options aren't that great for it, which manual rack was really the only option. So putting an electric motor in the column seemed the best option. We have had a little bit of trouble this weekend though with it not being efficient enough. And we were sort of wondering whether with the load of the new aero and everything that it just can't keep up with it. So
that would make sense as you add more aero load, the steering effort does increase. Speaking of the aerodynamics here, again, I mentioned probably not the most aerodynamic platform to start with, but obviously at World Time Attack, you need some downforce. And a lot of people are going to pretty extreme measures there, getting specific aerodynamic components designed around their car. How have you actually designed or developed the aero package on this car?
We started with a small basic splitter, and then over the years, like it was pretty well balanced, but just dealing with Sydney composites and just using their universal package. And yeah, it seems like it's working really well this year. But yeah, again, it's where do you stop of involving a full aerodynamic package to develop a brick.
I think what you've just mentioned there, most people do think that they need to deal with an aerodynamicist to develop something, but these are universal components. So you've got a splitter, you've got a diffuser, and you've got a rear wing, and within reason, these parts can be adapted to just about any platform. And hey, maybe you're not going to get the absolute perfect potential out of it, but a good increase in performance.
Yeah, I think it's also hard too, like unless you have all that data to go with it, potentiometers to get ride heights and everything, it's hard to tell you what's going on other than, you know, feel seat of the pants feeling. So,
and I mean particularly as well, if you're not a professional driver, there's something to be said for the feedback from the driver, I think.
Absolutely, yeah, look, I'm definitely the hold back of this car. It's not the aero, that's for sure. So
all right, let's talk about the brake package. You work at V-Sport, who supply brake components to the likes of the supercars in Australia.
Yep.
I'm guessing you've got something pretty special going on there.
Yeah, look, obviously it's 15-inch wheels, but maximum, we'll try to get the maximum there. So it's got a 4-piston AP caliper on the front with a 295mm disc by 32mm thick. And on the rear, it's got a Brembo 4-piston with a 296mm disc. So
with that 15-inch wheel, that's obviously restricting the size of the rotor you can run. Time Attack, obviously you're not going out and doing an hour of lap after lap running.
Yep.
Any problems with brake cooling with that 15-inch package?
No, not at all. And look, to be honest, I'm trying to do more laps with it, not just do one. So yeah, no, the brakes are very, very good.
And also the pedal box in it. Can you talk us through what that is and why a pedal box is a valuable addition to a race car?
Yeah, look, a pedal box just gives the limiting factor of a factory master, as you know, is giving that balance. They're very front bias, so to try and get the rear actually working, and putting that pedal box in gives you that direct feel because you've lost the booster, and setting up the master cylinders correctly and getting that brake balance as close to 50-50 as possible.
Safe to assume you've also got some data on brake pressures front and rear, so you can actually assess what the bias is.
And certainly for an amateur driver, being able to get someone that knows what they're doing and go, you know, seeing what you're pushing and being able to say, look, no, you're not pushing hard enough, or, you know, the pads aren't working for you, or what it might be.
So what are you using in terms of data or just your feedback on track to help you dial in that balance or bias of that pedal box? I'm guessing you've got it pretty dialed in now, but initially when you were setting up, what's the process you've gone through?
Yeah, look, initially when I started with the car, it had two muscles on the firewall before the pedal box, and I just resurfaced what was there. I didn't like the particular pedal feel that the old owner had, so I changed muscle sizes to suit me. And then as we put the pedal box in, I'm just using people around me that are more knowledgeable and better racers than I am at what I should be looking for, and obviously what we've learned over the years with what we do. So
as soon as you've got wheel speed data and brake pressures as well, those are really big helps in the data to sort of analyse exactly what's happening and which end of the car's locking up first. Look, John, I know that you're just about to head out for a session. We've sort of cornered you and managed to get as much detail as we can in a pretty quick format. So I appreciate your time. I won't hold you up, and good luck for the rest of the day.
Appreciate it. Thank you very much. Cheers.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.